First on the agenda today, I do have a guest who will make a presentation maybe here later on in the agenda. Anita Deming, who will be representing Brass and handing out some updated information from that. So until she comes, we will just move forward with the agenda. Next on the agenda are communications. I guess I would ask for a motion to file all communications.
I'll make that motion.
Moved by Mr. Morris. Second. By Mr. Phillips. Questions, comments? All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. Next on the agenda, to adopt the minutes from August 19th, I think it was. 2014, the last regular board meeting. Someone would like to move that?
I'll move that.
Moved by Mr. Alcott.
I'll second.
Second by Mr. Phillips. Comments, questions on the regular board meeting minutes, August 19th. Being none, all those in favor? Mm-hmm. Opposed? Those have been adopted. Secondly, we did have a public hearing on that same night at 6:30 on representations for the comprehensive plan, version 7. We'll ask for a motion to accept those minutes.
I'll make a motion we accept those minutes.
Moved by Mr. Phillips. Second by Mr. Wright. Comments, questions on the public hearing minutes? Being none, all those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Opposed? That carries. Thank you very much. Okay, then we will move right to old business. First, under old business, the comprehensive plan. As many of you are aware, we had just conducted a public hearing on the number 8 revision of the updated comprehensive plan for the town of Elizabethtown. We had a few comments. I think everyone present and that has been a party to this process over the last few months would recognize that there has been quite a few implementations of suggestive changes, revisions, and things like that, that the group have implemented as was the desire of the information that was received through these public hearings and other workshop periods. I believe personally that we now have a document that I am ready to forward to this board for consideration of adoption at this time. So without further ado, I will make the motion to adopt the comprehensive plan version 8 that is before us. And I would look for a second. For discussion. Second by Mr. Alcott. Okay. Under discussion, any comments, questions on the comprehensive plan or the information that we've received to this date? Being none, I would ask for a roll call vote, please, on it.
Mr. Morris?
Yes.
Mr. Alcott?
Yes.
Mr. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Phillips?
Yes.
And Mr. Merrigan?
Yes. Thank you very much. And again, my commendation to everyone involved and all the people, even at the start when you had your original work sessions and information gathering and things like that. It's been a long process, but I believe a very worthwhile process. And thank you again for that process. And thank you to the board members for attending all these and your input also. So I think we do have a plan that the town can be proud of and we can use as an instrument going forward, hopefully again to move us further down the road with our local law in the event that we do have consideration of modification and updating that document also. So again, thank you to everyone involved in this process. Okay. Next, under old business, I have the highway garage. And the highway garage, as everyone remembers, we've gone back and forth on getting quotes on roof replacement and coming up with an agreed request for proposals that we can put out this month for contractors to review and submit bids on. As most people remember, this is the last updated. We're looking at a cost or a price estimated at around $75,000, and that could go plus or minus $10,000, as you all understand how the bidding process goes. So I guess I would ask for a motion to move forward with the formal public notice to receive bids for the roof replacement and incorporating the NYSERDA information for also updating the electrical services, the lights, the doors, and things like that in its entirety. So again, I would ask for a motion to allow me to, or us, to move forward in advertising for those bids to go forward.
I'll make the motion.
Moved by Mr. Wright.
I'll second it.
Second by Mr. Phillips. And now under discussion. I know there must be questions or comments, and that I know you, when I say you, I know Jim and BJ and Rick has been involved here also, not that Ben hasn't, that you also have been involved with some of the contractors and the bidders that have supplied us information at this point. So I would ask that you contact them and try to be as competitive as possible when they consider us for work here in the near future.
So they just got to put in the bid and then we've got a certain day that's going to have to be in. You're going to set a day for that?
Yeah, that would be in the legal notice. Okay. That will be
it'll put, be in the paper?
Yeah. With this
run that in the Valley News? Or?
Set of specifications, probably, yeah, I'm not sure. Probably the Plattsburgh Press.
Okay.
It just it seems to hit a wider array of contractors up in the area. But. That's it. Any other questions or comments on that? And I know we're getting along a little bit in the construction year, but we have a lot of different projects, so this is a necessary step forward for us to go. That being said, then, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And I may sit down once I compiled what I believe are the covering all the bases for the specifications that we put out to make sure that you concur with that information. Thank you. Next, speaking of roofs, the town hall roof. And, you know, again, I know many of the board members have been involved in this process. Mr. Phillips had given me another contractor's contact information. I had reached out to that company 3 weeks ago trying to get just a quote, an emergency contract, anything to take care of the flashing problem that we have up around the cupola here. To this point in time, there has been no definitive feedback from the four contractors that I have contacted at this point. So I just want y'all to know that I'm not just sitting here I have reached out to these people, whether or not I've got to put this out to a legal bid or not. I'm a little bit, frustrated that we haven't had more of a response to that. But all I can say is I will try to recontact those people. But again, it's an emergency contract, just with a quote, and I have not had positive commitments yet.
I'll talk to him tomorrow.
Okay, thank you. So again, it's on the agenda. Hopefully we won't have much rain. Next, under sidewalks. Again, I would ask this time for board authorization for the supervisor to advertise for bids for sections of sidewalks on the western side of Water Street and to address certain safety issues that have been identified by, you know, various board members. We certainly don't want to put ourselves in a libelous situation, but there's the long stretch on Water Street that had always been intended to be repaved. I have no idea the cost of concrete has gone up 30% since the last time I was involved in this.
So it's over $100 a yard.
Yeah, so it could be an eye-opener. It doesn't mean we're committed to have to do it, but I think we do have to do it. We have some real safety issues out there. This is a bondable capital project. Sometimes bonding is frowned upon, but bonding to me is the most fair way to spread the tax burden out with people. Bonding is generally for the life expectancy of the capital improvement that you're doing, allows us to put a sidewalk out for a bonding period of 15 to 20 years. That is much more fair than trying to pay for it in one lump sum. If you've been living there for 35 years and you decided to move next week, you don't get hit with that burden. It should be spread out, you know, among them all. So again, I would ask for a motion to allow the supervisor to advertise for bids for sidewalks predominantly on Water Street.
I'll make that motion.
Moved by Mr. Morris.
I'll second.
And second by Mr. Alcock. And again, any areas that you certainly identify as board members to say, that's a danger, we need to address that also, because we can piecemeal these once we get a contractor in the area.
There is some up there.
There's a few of them out there, so I'd better to identify them all and just get us through them whether one way or the other.
Noel, I don't know if it's the right time to bring it up. At one time we were talking about, a while back, are we going to continue sidewalks everywhere, too?
That's a good point.
You know, I mean...
We did entertain the consideration, like you were saying, on one side of Water Street is to abandon or consider that.
I don't know if that should be brought up again and considered at this, you know, at some point.
I always would certainly entertain that for consideration. I have talked to a few of the property owners. Some property owners don't really care one way or the other. They understand they're all taxpayers and we have very good, or will have very good sidewalks on the other side. But there's some landowners, and I'm sure some of them have approached you all, who would like to maintain their sidewalks on that side of the street. But I sort of agree with Mr. Moore. Sometimes
well,
there's a redundancy.
I don't remember the exact spots, but we had talked about it before.
Yes.
At a point.
I think if we can
eliminate one instead of maintain it, that's...
That's right.
We don't need it.
That's right. In the long run, I think that could be a long-term cost savings with the amount of money that...
Right.
We now understand.
One other thing, too. Down by Hagelfields, when they did that water project, there's one of those snap gutters light that got undermined, and they put cold patch on it. Is there a chance that, is that our responsibility, or what is that?
That should be state DOT. If it's not under the sidewalk, you know, when it's a gutter drainage kind of thing, it should be, but that's something that maybe Tommy and I...
told it. It wasn't fixed when that water project went through, so I'll speak to him in the morning and let you know what he said.
Okay. I do know, just because I'm there every night, the sidewalk, driveway sidewalk, going down to Boca River Housing.
Right.
Lawrence Way, that half of that sidewalk's gone.
Yeah, I know.
You know, and that's one portion, but the sidewalk probably is our responsibility at that point. And along those same lines as BJ has brought up, when we had done the other capital project, mostly here on Court Street, but also down on the commercial end of Water Street, the pieces on the ramps with the sidewalk allows you to go back down into a parking lot and then come back up. Some of those that had the little nubbings on them to keep traction when you're walking in the winter, some of those nubbings have completely gone. I have not, at this point in time, been able to find the right supplier to be able to say, and it should be that easy, but the state, I just said, can we just have what you had before? So we're still sort of working on that, but I know there's four or five of those that need to be replaced. That's our responsibility.
Down there by the upstate and that bottle redemption place.
Okay, yep.
There's, they put that, like you said, drop down, then they come up.
Right.
People sometimes they go right over the side, but they think that.
Because it hits.
Bit of a 6-inch drop there.
It does. Okay, so sidewalks certainly are an issue, and I know we're getting along in the season, but I did talk to two contractors today. They both would like to walk the areas that we're interested in, because as you all know, because you've been in the business, putting in a 4-foot sidewalk to me is easy. Okay, you just lay down the cement. On Water Street, there's a lot more to it than that. We've got big tree problems. We've got retainage wall problems. We've got some other step problems. So there's a lot more to it than just simply laying concrete. I mean, that's going to be reflected, I believe, in the totality of the bid. But,
to move the sidewalks into another subject, the bridge on that end of Water Street, which has a sidewalk on it.
Right.
Is there any movement on that at all, or?
I have had no conversation with the state.
Because we're still experiencing it's falling apart, and plus we're getting a huge amount of traffic up that street.
Oh, it is.
Which you know.
Yeah. No, the traffic and
it's not
individual.
It's not local slow traffic.
That's right. No.
So
it's Easterners heading to Lake Placid.
Yes,
most get of through the small town.
And no, coming and back too.
And yeah, both ways. Yeah, yeah, you're right.
No.
Because there was two today, but they were, I was at Sally's dropping her off now, but they did 50 up through there.
Oh, yeah. Well, the thing is that bridge is falling apart, right?
Yeah, it is. And it's getting narrow. You know, we've got a plowing season coming and all that.
No, I'm not changing the subject, but remember when you asked me about that curb? The pieces of curb you wanted?
Yes.
Tommy said that there should be some up the county highway. They ain't even get it out of concrete building supply 5 foot.
But there might be some at DPW?
That's what he said.
Okay, and I know that they did do some of the repairs with the curbing that we had. I'm just not sure if we had any other.
Well, you asked me about that, and when you brought up that show, I just thought about that.
No, thank you. I appreciate that. Okay, then ending sidewalks, had a motion and a second to allow the supervisor to put in a legal notice for bids. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And that carries. Thank you. Next under old business, the fuel tank at the highway garage. Thank you all for your help in that matter. Earth Science Engineering completed the job last Thursday, I believe it was. So it's there, they're taking care of all of the communication with the DEC. And that should be moving forward, and we're done with that, and then we'll be left with an inert tank, and I think we do whatever we want with that. So that's one that's off the table.
Right.
They submit all of the paperwork communication to DEC, and then we'll be done with that as well. So we need no action on that. I just want to let you know it took a little bit of time. It was relatively expensive. It was probably a $3,000 expenditure, and that was the lowest bid that we got. So
we had to get it done.
That's it. Yeah. Once people are made aware, it's you've got no negotiation there at all. Okay, I'm going to do the last one under old business, and we'll put Miss. No, don't be sorry. No, you're fine. You really are. Under water meters, I just wanted to again say I think we are about in the same spot we were at the last meeting. We're waiting on 4 or 5 last installations that my water commissioner has agreed to undertake, and there has been, unless something's happened here in the last couple of weeks, no progress on that. There are 2 properties that require new services so that there can be integrity to the line, so we can put on a new water meter for that. So it's up to him to coordinate the workers that he has. They go do the work. The property owners aren't built for that work, but those arrangements haven't been made. We're receiving some pressure to close that project out, so hopefully we'll make some progress here in the next couple of weeks on that, or they will have a little more time to commit to that than what they've had in the past. Any other old business yet? Go ahead.
There's leftover parts up there for that. Are they taking them back to the store so we can get them?
On the additional parts, we're supposed to sit down and do an audit, and there's certain pieces that they felt, and this is with Dave's input also, that we would keep an inventory because it's a very aggressive price that we got in the total bid as far as additional pumps and horns and things like that. But the other pieces, parts that are deemed.
Meters and all that.
Right.
They can go back. Right?
Yes. Yeah. Because it was, there's a term for it, not a lump sum bid, but there's an itemization bid. So they had to bid the totality of the total number of pieces, whether you use them or not. Then they are committed to have to take those back at that agreed price. So hopefully once he's all done with that, they'll do an audit and not have any extras that that we don't need, and then we will receive credit back for that. But thank you for that reminder. Any other old business?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. How about the valves up to the water department?
Those should be. The valves were ordered through Mr. Jack Dodson, and I'm anticipating a delivery sometime either the end of this week or next week. Once that's done, you know, as they know, it won't be Dave, but under Dave's tutelage, then we will get resident construction to come up and actually do the changeover for that. It's a sequential kind of
thing. It's getting pretty late now. So.
And I know that the real reason for you to ask that is we need the hydrants flushed. And that was one of the, I won't say excuses, but one of the reasons Dave was representing that he can't do that. So anyways, that should all be done here within I would hope within 2 weeks, and then the hydrants will take priority. But Dave's getting a little more on his plate now than he had before. But these things are all building up, like you say, the season.
Has she had a leak up the ground in there?
Yep, and we had one down at the hand house. You know, those are all, you know, all on private,
right.
Private, but they still need attended to. Okay. Other old business? You can come back if you.
Just, you know, I don't know if it's really old, but I was supposed to talk about surplus with Mike stuff, and I haven't. And we'll do that. The time went by in a hurry, but I will bring that up.
Okay.
Try to get there real soon and talking about the surplus stuff.
Oh, and that's just like stuff that's extra that we're going to sell. And, okay.
Okay.
No, good. But, other old business? Once or twice. Then I would like to introduce this evening Sunita Deming, who is here representing Barrasque, Boquette River. I'll allow you to.
Okay, the Boquette River Association, yes. Thank you very much. I did ask to come and present at the board meeting. We have been doing one of those state plans. You guys, I think, did one for your town. We're doing a watershed management plan for the Boquette River Association, or for the Boquette River Watershed. And in the middle of it, our director, we just didn't have enough funds to continue on with our director. So basically it's fallen back onto all of the board volunteers to do all the work. Well, we actually hired Ann Holland as a consultant for it, because we had the grant money. So that grant money has been used for that. And so one of the things we've been doing is going to each of the town board meetings and explaining to them, you know, what we've done and what we found and where we're working on it. The goal is by September 30th to have all of the input from everybody as far as issues and concerns and things that you would like to have addressed by the Boquette River Association. you know, in the next 5 years or whatever it might be, or issues that you see that we might start to think about. So in that line, we did a whole bunch of maps, you know, because that's what planners do. So, and it just turns out that, you know, Elizabethtown is almost entirely inside of our watershed, so it works very nicely. And we've got, yeah, thank you, I'll just leave these over here and I'll leave them for now. And so everything is going to be in the booklet that we end up coming up with, and, you know, basically the works, our input is through September 30th now, and then the book will be coming out in November sometime. And then there'll be a chance for everybody to review that also. And then, you know, hopefully we'll have a document that's sort of says these are the current issues in the watershed. And so I do have these maps, and I can leave them here because I don't expect you to investigate them in great detail at this point. But I will leave them here for you to look at for a week or so. And aren't they cool? Yes. So this one is population change, you know, so you can see where the population is. And oh, this one is bedrock geology, and you know, they're all superimposable. Surficial geology,
management plan,
physiography, that's just topo map. There's a couple of them that are kind of interesting that I thought I would try to pull out if I can find a location map that's easy. These are the watersheds. One of the things we did as a part of this project is we have sampled twice this summer all of the sub watersheds. So we've got chemistry information on all of the sub-watersheds. And we keep, I gotta tell you, we keep trying to find something in each. I shouldn't tell you that, because you're right there. You know, cauliflower or something, because you don't, nothing. We got nothing on that, just so you know. But anyway, yeah, there you go, that's good. We don't really need a wastewater treatment facility. Anyway, this is all of the brooks.
We change day to day.
Pardon?
Cauliflower can change.
Well, that's so quick. It's right. You got to be there at the right time. That's the deal with that. It goes through quickly. And frankly, cauliflower is very perishable. You know, it doesn't last a long time, so unless it's a totally gross, you know, problem. But and then there's phosphorus. And then there's planting maps.
That's a good one.
Yeah. We'll have real nice ones at the end. These are our working drawings, and we already know problems that are with them already. You know, we already know that we've got some problems, but we're looking, one of the reasons I want to leave them here is for you to look through them and see any problems that you see. You know, things that you say, this isn't
that
right.
Just jumps out at us.
Right. You know, like, these are the industrial things, and I think they've got industrial, this is AP land use. But there's a spot where they've got industrial stuff, and it ends up, it's, you know, the SUNY Plattsburgh property over there at Twin Brooks, you know, that, well, that's not really industrial, it's commercial.
Right.
Yeah. But that's the way real property tax has it down. So, you know, we know there's certain problems that are in here just already. And we know that the zoning is only in the hamlet of Elizabethtown.
That's what I was looking at.
Oh, yeah. You don't think somebody named Deming got all over that one. But anyway, yeah, so this would be the farmland, the brown parts. So here, you guys don't get to see it, but the brown parts are the farmland, obviously, and you don't have a lot of that in Elizabethtown, so we don't have to worry about that. This is rare and endangered species. So this is a rare and it's a very big dots that they've got on there, because they don't want people going in and bothering them, you know. So, but that's
they have been identified.
Well, Ann Holland is a real, I don't know if you know her, but
I do.
She is quite a grant writer and very, very detailed, and she did a wonderful job for us as far as finding all of the data that's out there in digital form and putting it together on these maps. So we've got that.
Critical areas.
This is the critical environmental areas. Well, you know, the entire, like a quarter mile around the Beaufort River is critical environmental habitat. Y'all know that if you ever do permitting. So that's all just part of what you have to deal with in this. So that's APA thing. This is one that's infrastructure. So we've got, one of the things we did was we went around and we had volunteers that went to every culvert, state, county, and town road. We went to every culvert and inventoried if it had been changed by Irene, which you had quite a bit up on Lincoln Pond that was changed over.
Right.
And so we've got those, that data in there, and that's all being reviewed and updated for what's going on with the, you know, the fish passage. That's the big thing. We do, we are concerned about fish passage, you know, because fishing is one of the big things that people like to do on the river. And so we're trying to support that. That's one of the things that we do. We also are very concerned about skin contact and people swimming, because people like to swim in the river. So we're very concerned about the E. coli and potential bacteria or pathogens that might be in the water. Okay. And, you know, we don't worry as much about drinking water, because drinking water, well, nobody's really using the river for drinking water.
Right.
And
it's treated.
And it's treated. It's got chlorine in it, so it kills things off. But it, so the things, and fish propagation. And one of the big things with fish propagation is chlorine. And so whenever you put in a wastewater treatment facility, you know, you have the wastewater treatment facility, and it's like, oh, good, you know, we're saving. But one of the things they do is they put chlorine in it to kill off all the bacteria that are coming through there, and that's bad for fish. So that's sort of one of those catch-22s. You have to weigh it this way, and you have to weigh it that way. And so that's one of the things that we look at. This is prime farmland. You don't have a ton of prime farmland in Etown, and none of it is in an agriculture. Oh, no, there's a little bit over by Rob Bridge. There's a couple of properties over there that are in the Ag District, but mostly Elizabethtown doesn't have much in the Ag District. But I'm working to change that.
That's
in New
right.
Russia. I hate to tell you,
yeah.
We are out there clearing trees like crazy, John.
There's some good fields up there already.
Pardon?
There's some good fields up there already.
I just went around with the state specialist trying to decide what kind of grass to plant. So, anyway, this is the highly erodible land. Okay, so the brown stuff is steep and it's highly erodible. You know, can we figure that out? And one of the things is sand is also very highly erodible. And so we find a lot of problems with bank erosion on the Boca, especially in Elizabethtown.
Watch out.
Right. I don't think I have an invasive species map on here, but that's another thing that we have done, is we have mapped the invasive species.
That's a living
this
document.
This is erosion. Let's see, erosion. Oh, septic suitability, here you go. There's the septic suitability map, and that's one that, you know, we kind of care about, is whether or not the septic tank's got 4 feet of usable soil. And, you know, y'all know that's a big issue. It's, you need to have 2 feet over the septic system, or the leach field, because you don't want it to freeze. And then you need 2 feet of arable soil with oxygen spaces in it so that it can have active biological activity going on around those soil particles that break down whatever's coming out of the leach field. So essentially you need 4 feet of usable soil, and that can be tricky in some locations. So that's the septic suitability. And
I feel like we have a lot of pink here.
Yeah, well, that's bedrock. Sure. Yeah, that's yeah. Even more. Those are the mountains. We don't have yet, but anyway, that's a soil erosion inventory. That's just along the roads. That was a roadside thing. You know, because most of our inventories are roadside. Probably 30 years ago now, I'm dating myself, I hate to tell you, we did a bank erosion survey where we went down the river. I think we flew it in a helicopter, actually, and we took pictures of the bank to see where it was eroding and whatever. And a lot of that is still continuing. There is a lot of bank erosion on the river. Some of it has helped. We've lost, you know, sometimes the farms go right up to the edge of the river, and that's really, really causes problems. Elizabethtown doesn't have a lot of farms, so that's not a big issue. But you do have a lot of velocity, because it comes down off the mountains, and it can come down at some pretty high speeds. And velocity, and that does take it. And you know, certainly even through the hamlet, you have huge erosion problems down by the footbridge and places like that. And so, erosion is one of our big issues that we work on. what's this one?
Developed versus under.
Oh yeah, this is developed versus underdeveloped. So commercial development is this pretty little color right here. We don't see a lot of that in there. And then of course this is state land that's green. And so there's a variety of types in Elizabethtown. This is the Elizabethtown part, obviously.
These are great maps.
Yep. This is a tax parcel map and the land use that the tax parcels. And so, yeah, you can see, like, I think Twin Brooks is this right here. You know, so that's like, yeah, that's not industrial, even though it's got a purple commercial thing on it. But it happens to be a college is incorporated, so and they own it, and so that's how that ended up. So we know that not all of these things are really perfect, but it's just a way for us to kind of go through and look at how are things impacting the watershed. Owner-occupied housing. So this is what percent is owner-occupied and what percent is seasonal, you know, second owners. This is land use change, land cover change. So the yellow parts are where things have been cleared. You can see we don't have a whole lot of in development going on. I'm not even showing this to you guys. I'm so sorry.
Is that the same map?
Well, yeah. So I'm leaving all these maps. You can look at them. I just wanted to tell you, and the other thing is that our inventories have shown, let's see, what's this? Oh, this is dams.
The impairments. Yeah.
Dams, mines, sewage treatment, you know, some of the bigger things that you might worry about, landfills, stuff like that. The one thing that I wanted to say that we don't have a map for right now is the invasive species, and that is on IMAP Invasives, which is a statewide thing, and we're going to get that pulled together for the book. Okay. But we have recently found about an acre of black swallowwort in Elizabethtown. And so the River Association, you know, like I said, we don't have a director anymore, but we are putting our efforts toward developing a group of friends. And friends means people that will come out and help us work on stuff. And one of the things that we do is go out and dig up invasive species. We pick up litter in the river. We plant a lot of trees. We got, I think, 250 trees coming in here in next week to be planted. None of them in E-Town, I'm sorry, but you know, yeah. We do, yeah. So, but those are the kinds of things that we're doing. We're actively seeking friends, and we have this watershed management project. The other grant that we've got that we are working on right now is wollastonite tailing filter bed in Willsboro at the Willsboro Wastewater Treatment Facility. And we thought that was going to be a great project, and it worked wonderfully for about a month and a half. And then the water went down, and it went down and went down, and pretty soon there's no water flowing through it whatsoever. And so we are going to dig up the filter bed and see what's going on with it. We believe what happened once before was that a sock was put around the, you know, a very fine filter fabric was put around the pipes, and it filled up in another spot that wasn't part of the affluent, you know, the outflow. It was more part of the inflow where they were. But it filled up with fines from the water, and then it plugged up, and then it just didn't move water. And the actual engineering plans just called for pea gravel to be around it so that it would have more surface to go out. And so we're going to dig that up, see if that's the problem, put in pea gravel. We got a grant for that. That's out in Willsboro. But, you know, that is a really nice. We found that wollastonite, it's calcium metasilicate. And so that's just the chemical thing for it. Meta means lots of. And so at Cornell, they took some of this wollastonite and they've been filtering it through, you know, bubbling wastewater effluent through it. And they find with less than a 24-hour contact period, they can reduce the amount of phosphorus coming out of the effluent by almost 90%. No active thing, just a, and it becomes calcium metaphosphate. So you're just taking the phosphorus out. It's an ionic charge that's going on in there. And what a great way to remove phosphorus. And then you got a product that goes onto farm fields and helps fill them up. You know, it's just perfect. And silicon going out, you know, silicon is sand, right? I mean, it's not really a bad thing in the environment. So if you can take the phosphorus out of the effluent, what a great idea. So, and we got it all over the place, you know, I mean, last night. So that's the other project that we're working on, plus the invasive species project. And those are the three grants that we have right now that we're trying to finish up. I do not believe that we're going to be able to hire another director for a while. We just don't. The grant funds are really hard to come by, especially for something like that. Yeah. And so the board is doing the work, plus our friends, and we are hiring contractors. So if we get a grant, we then hire a contractor, for instance, like we're hiring Ann Holland, to do the project for us and get something. So that's our current vision. And did I give you my letter?
Yes.
Okay.
And I will make copies.
That's my letter requesting support from the town.
Yes.
And that's an address to Noel requesting, you know, funding support for the Boca River Association. And like I said, I will leave these maps here. And
you want to change that?
Pardon, did I say what?
Last year's budget.
Oh, I've got the wrong date. Oh,
great.
Well, I was doing that's why I'm late. You want to know the truth?
Not a problem. So,
I knew exactly.
This will look great on TV, won't it? I need a Debbie. That's what's up. Anyway, so, yeah. So, yeah. I got some of the things right
now. Absolutely.
All right.
No, thank you. This is,
thank you.
This is
beautiful. Yep. It'll be a really great document. You know, maps are a lot more fun to look at than the words. But, and I also have it sorted out how many acres of hamlet, how many acres of this and that. And in the book, we're going to sort it by town as well. We've made that decision. And I think that's really good for Elizabethtown because, like I said, you're almost all entirely in the watershed. So things that come out for the town is going to be, you know, right.
It's a benefit for
right,
us.
Right, exactly. You know, for you guys to think about. So, okay. Yeah,
thank you very much.
Did I talk fast enough? That I you took longer than I said I would. Didn't
you did.
I?
No, very, very, very good presentation.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Beautiful.
Yeah, we got more here.
That's right.
This is my second team. I got to take my other hat off.
Now that you got the crowd warmed up. Good evening, everyone. I'm going to allow you guys, I know you're probably not quite prepared, but you've been listening a little bit, that you can come right on and
be
part of the presentation. I will introduce, this is Patty and Larry Baja, who are representing the Elizabethtown Lewis Ambulance Emergency Squad.
Correct.
And Ms. Karen Brown is a bodyguard.
Yeah. Well, my husband just called out on the call.
You want this to stuff in my
awesome.
Yeah, no.
I ever seen
thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you got the rest, you could hand me. You want to take a couple of those? Because it's enough there, I think, for members of the audience, and it's part of the awareness.
I've seen that, yes.
You got me going in crossfire. And they're not numbered or lettered, so when you refer to a document, it's going to be damn late. Oh, that's an extra.
I guess I'm going to do the easy part and give you the numbers and letters. Why? As you can see, what I gave the board was a chart basically outlining the last 8 years. 2007, we received $23,000 in a stipend from the town. From that point until 2013, we didn't receive any money from the town for our operational budget. In 2013, town took $2,000 away from us out of our fund, out of our operational budget. And just so you're aware, in 2012 and 2013, having that shortfall, and also with our operational budget, we had to use our reserve money, which was dedicated for our ambulance. That was another $10,000 that we had to take out of a reserve fund, plus our savings in order to catch up with the operational side of it. So I went down through, and right up front, let you know, and so you, and she can explain why. We're looking for $15,000 this year from the town. I spoke to Charlie Lewis at Real Property. What's that amount to for the town of Elizabethtown? It equates to less than $10 per 100,000 in additional taxes for the taxpayers for emergency services guaranteed to come to their door. Some other stats I wanted to give you real quick, like the average squad member in our department, and we have 22 full-time volunteers, the average squad member is putting in at least a 40 to a 60 hour week a month to be on call, respond, and that doesn't include actually responding to the calls. That's just to be on call. And we have several, like somebody standing behind me, that are doing over 100 hours a month. And these are dedicated hours. They're not just wait for the bell to go off. They're dedicated hours that they're actually taking out of their time to be on call. And in light of, or with all of that being mentioned, two other points I'd like to make. I did some research and did quite a bit of due diligence as far as what other towns are paying for the EMS service that is received by the town of Etown and Lewis. And right now the contract, if an outside service was to come in here because we can no longer operate, it would cost the town on the average between $325,000 to $400,000 according to this bid, which came from Memorial Ambulance Service. That is with one ambulance and two EMTs. That's what they would provide.
And we do three people on a run.
Yeah, we do three, primarily four on the most calls. This call went out, so there's three on this call. The town of Bolton, they do 250 plus or minus calls a year, just like we do. Their town supports them with $145,000 a year, and they get $100,000 from billing revenue for their calls. I was really interested in one, and that was in the town of Altona in Clinton County. And if you've read the Adirondack Park assessment review, you'll see in there's a part on EMS, and this is where the trend is going, and it's only reality. And what we're trying to do, obviously, is to work with the town boards to not reach that reality yet. In Clinton County, Altona contracted with Morrisonville EMS to provide services to them. Morrisonville has 25 volunteers. They have two paid staff, and they just hired four more paid staff to cover Altona. They're charging Altona, the town of Altona, they do 250 calls a year. They're supplying for them right now an EMT and a critical care tech and an ambulance. And they're charging them $32,000 a month. They aren't able to bill for their services each and every time they pick up a patient. As soon as they receive their CON to operate, have a certificate of need for that town, that budget, which is right now is $368,000 for 12 months, is going to go to $420,000, and they're going to collect all the money for the billing. And they will supply an ambulance and two EMTs. So that's what's happening in EMS. And that's why we're trying to do our best with this money for our operational budget. We're trying to keep it down and work with you guys, and I'll let her explain why.
Thank you.
Because we're good people, that's why. Oh, so anyway, I gave you a bunch of stuff. Can I just use you for a game tape for a second?
I'm used to it.
This, the fund drive just went out. It should be in the mail. If you haven't gotten it, you'll probably be getting it in the next day or two. So this is the front side. There's actually two sides to that. I'm giving this to the board and to the audience just so they can have a background as to what we, you know, what we're looking for and what we've done. This next part shows our expenses, which I'll go over in a second. This is just literally documentation of our operational costs and what the impact will be per thousand on a household. And then, I won't go over this part, but they always find this kind of interesting. These are the statistics of what we did last year for calls. It breaks it down to age. Obviously, there's no HIPAA or confidentiality information here, but age, the residency, you know, where we picked them up to, what we took them to, some of the chief complaints that we see out there, and then that's the first front and back. Then the next sheet is what the squad are doing, the members are doing themselves. So you can see where our call volume is looking like. And then the other one, which I won't really touch on a whole lot, but this just shows our funding. Obviously, the big part here is the billing, which we're going to talk about in a second. Our fund drive, we didn't do one last year because the volunteers, primarily myself, didn't get to it. But like I said, it's already out in the mail for this year. Our general donations go up and down. You see this big spike on the general donations because we got a very nice contribution from a local person. Quite a significant amount of money that helped go towards our new Zoll monitors, which I'll speak about in a second. And you can see our funding has been pretty consistent and flat with Lewis and Elizabethtown. It's been pretty consistent. So in 1 year, there was a dip here. That was in 2013. So you can see that. Now, so on the expense side, there's two reasons basically why we're asking for more money this year. One is just plain old operational costs. You can see, and we'll talk about how we've been trying to save money this year that we're in. Training is a little underspent. Insurance costs have gone up, as you can see, over the last year. I'm looking at this form here now. Employee costs, we spent $45,000 last year. $38,000 is year to date now. I think we'll get pretty close to $45,000, and I'll talk about us needing more paid staff in a second. General operational costs, we've been trying to keep that in check. Insurance costs have been pretty consistent. I'm sorry, insurance billing, that's what we have to pay for the billing part. Pagers, you'll see there's quite a jump this year. We had to buy 30 pagers because it's going from high band paging to low band paging. The fire departments just have to do the same thing, or we'll be doing the same thing, right?
Yeah, the Etown fire will.
Oh, yeah. Wow. All right, anyway, they'll be doing the same thing. Because of the new radio system, they're going to low band paging. We've been high band paged forever. Our radio is actually in the old jail over here. So anyway, that's a good thing. Ambulance repairs, we've been really good with that. And you'll see a loan repayment plan. The first loan repayment that started in 2013, you see is pretty small. That is for the USDA loan grant that we are paying on. We pay once a year on that. You see it bumped up to a little over $11,000 this past year. We took out a loan to pay for the pagers and the Zoll monitors. We borrowed $64,000, and we'll speak to how we got a really decent rate on insurance rate, interest rate on that. But we're paying on those little monitors. Any questions on the expenses? So I'm gonna talk about that a little bit more here. Is that yours? You got one. Okay. Any questions? Okay. So besides the operational costs, the other reason why we want to have or receive more money, and we're asking for the same amount from both towns, so we're not just picking on Elizabethtown, it's the same amount for both towns, is the $30,000 will probably just about cover a per diem staff for the weekends. We are having extremely a significant amount of issues covering the weekends. I'll give you an example. Next weekend, or this weekend coming up, I have a paid person on, and that's all that's on until I come on at 11, and then I'm by myself after 11, right now. Now, why not beat the volunteers to death and get somebody to volunteer? I'm hoping so. But this is the chronic situation every single weekend, just about. Every single weekend, we're having to look for additional paid people for the weekends. The volunteers are awesome. We don't have any dead weight on the squad. Everybody's mandated to put in 12 hours. Everybody's doing that in one shape or another. 12 hours for the month. Monday, to Friday during the day. We have a paid person, she's full-time, paid person, and we're moving an ambulance all the time during the day. At night, Monday through Friday, we have, like, the ambulance is out right now, we have at least three or four people on at night, all through the night. Our problems are the weekends, significant problems on the weekends. So, what we're hoping to do is to be able to hire per diem, so there's no benefits associated with that for the weekends. And if, like this weekend, and just one paid person's on, if we don't get additional volunteers to cover, we'll be picking on the fire departments to send us a driver. We'll page them out and ask for a driver. So, and we've done that pretty well, pretty successfully through the last few years. So that's why we're asking for the increase, operational costs and for a paid staff on the weekends. The ZOLL monitors, just to show you some examples of where we push the limit on everything and try to keep our costs down. The ZOLL monitors or cardiac monitors are also used to defibrillate people. Ours, I think, were either 12 or 14 years old. Their shelf life is 12. I mean, it's 7. So we were way past the usefulness of the ZOLL monitors to the point where it's getting a little sketchy is that they're actually going to work 100%, which that can't, I mean, if you croak, you need to be defibrillated, you need to have some electricity. So that can't happen. So we did buy 2 new ZOLL monitors. That was $63,000. We've already had one saved with that. And the person was right at the station. I don't know if you've heard about that, but we had a save. The person's home and doing extremely well. And it wasn't obviously just because of the new monitors. It was all about timing, but we had a paid person at the station. They drove into the dooryard. The person croaked or went to cardiac arrest in front of a paid person. other people showed up right away. We turned him around, and we left the hospital with him alert and oriented, not, you know, wondering, you know, what happened today. So, you know, it's all about having people in the right spot at the right time. So some other things we did. Larry's been, ever since he's come to the last board meeting down here, fiscal board meeting with you guys, he's been, he was asked to look for ways of cutting things from here, and he certainly went out and did that. He renegotiated a new contract with our auctioning companies and cut that in half. We got an awesome rate with Champlain National Bank for our loans. You want to just talk about that real quick?
Sure. Initially, the loan from Champlain, well, let me start there. We had to search for many financial institutions to do our due diligence. So I started checking with companies all up and down the Eastern Seaboard, and it ranged from 8% in Florida to as high as 10% out of Maine. I then decided I was going to go to the local banks and see what we could do there. I started going around, and finally I was able to find a bank that wanted to deal with us, and believe it or not, it's right across the street. We started out with a 4.99% interest rate, and I went back, had my second meeting, negotiated down to 4.5%, and then I went back and I said, you know, you're our local bank, we're the local emergency squad. What's the chance that we could get a better interest rate? And they said, what do you want to be at? And I said, I wanted to say a lot less than what I did, but I said 3.5%. And they went to a board meeting and they did it. And 2.5% is what the state revolving loan is for the state of New York, which takes about a year to get that because the Lewis Fire Department just did that. So to get 1%, to be a difference of 1%, it's pretty big.
Right.
It saved us over $3,000 in our purchase.
Watch the camera. So that was, we changed our fuel dealer. We cut that contract significantly.
Yeah. With the propane, up until September of last year, we were paying about $3.25 a gallon for propane. As you know, we had a terrible winter. And our company, our vendor decided that, you know, we'll fill your tank. They filled our tank, didn't tell us, you know, hey, the price is going to go up, didn't inform us. Well, by the time we got to March, our cost was $4.77 a gallon. It was costing us nearly $2,000 a month for fuel, for propane to heat our building. Immediately threw me into a whirlwind, and I went on a rampage, and I started going out. I went to 5 different vendors, one of which could not handle us, and I finally negotiated a price to $1.79, and that's what we paid no hazmat, no fuel surcharge, no delivery. And I had the other company, which was AmeriGas, they were going to just come pick up their tank, and I told them no, I held their tank hostage. I told them they weren't coming on our property unless we're gonna do a deal. And I negotiated for all of what we paid for the last bill, which was almost $1,700, less $50 for the removal, and a hazmat, which was less than 10, and a delivery fee, which was less than 8. As we got back in a check, it was over $1,600 that we got back in that. And we just did two other things. Our cleaning for the building, our cleaning supplies were running up because, like everybody else, we're running, trying to support local. But when we're trying to keep our fund, our costs down, it wasn't working out well. So we had Ecolab come in, and all of our cleaners are on the wall to clean our ambulances. To clean our floors, to clean our countertops in the kitchen, and as well as the floors in the building. And that's saving us quite a bit of money a year. And the last thing was our cell phones. We have cell phones in our ambulances. Now that everybody has a cell phone, we've decided to discontinue that contract, and that'll save us about $1,000. But in the propane alone, we figure that we're gonna, fortunately, it based on last year's numbers, and hopefully we don't have one year like that again, but that'll save us nearly $6,000 a year. Wow. That's where I went with after I left here last year.
So a couple more things, and I think we can wrap up. Our ambulance, the oldest ambulance, is 15 years old next year. So that obviously does need to start being looked at for replacement. Right now, if something happens to one of the ambulances that wasn't covered by insurance, like an accident or something, we wouldn't have, if we drained all of our resources, we could probably cover maybe half the cost of an ambulance. So obviously that's not very good for the business side of things. So I had another thought, I just think it just got out of my head. Anyway, any questions for us?
I don't have any.
I just commend you on, you know, all of the due diligence that we, and Larry and I have talked, you know, numerous times about this, and certainly we've addressed it, as you know, at the county level. The town of Elizabethtown is not unique in this situation, or the town of Lewis. Every town in Essex County is experiencing these problems. We can defer the cause and effect to the state or the requirements and things like that, but it doesn't matter because those are the rules that you have to play by now. It's just that simple. And the service that you all supply to the people is, you know, just of better importance. It's one of those things I don't think our constituency has the position to negotiate at this point, because the other alternative is we just do not have a service.
Right, and the only thing that makes me a little worried, and I don't think we're anywhere near that point. Crown Point, for an example, has lost their CON because they couldn't move an ambulance.
Right.
And obviously, you know, we're not, they were totally not moving ambulance like 70% of the time. Scroom Lake is having issues. They're working with their towns too to try to come up with, I think, 200 some odd thousand for pace.
North Hudson.
Yep, North Hudson. Yep. In North Hudson, right.
Same way.
So it's definitely, and you guys know who are in the fire departments, it's definitely a volunteer issue. When people are really busy, they have kids, they have more than one job. You know, we have people who work shift work and who are working on weekends already in a real job. So, you know, it's definitely, and you're right, the requirements, we're starting a new EMT course if anybody's interested. October 2nd, October 1st for Native, but October 2nd for the originals. And it's 160 hours worth of training now. So it'll run October through March, I think it is. There's a lot of
requirements.
But it's worth it. I mean, once you get your card, you're good. So it's easy after that. Any questions from us?
Well, not totally.
I know. I'm trying to make this easy.
I would open it up to the audience, actually, you know, if y'all had any questions for Patty or Larry. For more information.
We have a very good response time to our
Absolutely.
Calls,
Absolutely.
Considering to other areas.
No, there's only positive feedback, you know, when people certainly appreciate it, because I think everybody has been touched within that generic family. Either an uncle or brother or a cousin, something like that, has been very appreciative of, not necessarily the paid people, but the familiar faces that come forward. It's a comforting fact.
So we thank you for giving us, you know, time to listen to us, and we really appreciate it.
Does everybody understand that, you know, we do have paid people, but it's because we don't have enough volunteers, you know, and you need to run more than one person. You know, you can't drive the ambulance and do the work in the back. And
that's right.
And we do charge insurance, but we don't have the call volume that is able to cover all of our fixed costs, which we have the same fixed costs as, you know, a regular, you know, a fully paid ambulance. So the insurance does, your insurance rate does not go up because we charge it, okay? It's already in there. So, you know, it isn't like, you know, it's just money you weren't using before we started to charge, if you have insurance.
And,
right.
And that's
know,
why
if you don't have insurance, well, we're pretty mellow on that.
That's true. That is true.
The point being is, and that, I know that came up here last year, was all you guys are billing, and I think it was Jim that was saying it just about covers the cost of our full-time staff with us billing. It's about $83,000 a year. And with the benefits and her wage, that just about covers the cost of the paid person. So we're not making money billing. It's the beauty of billing is it allows us to have a paid person during the day.
No, I'm glad you pointed that out, because then you still have fixed and escalation cost of equipment and updates.
When there's a billing, is it just a certain rate for per call per person, or is it depending on their insurance, or depending on?
Well, yes and no. So they get billed, the billing side. There's BLS, which is basically you scoop up most of the people, and they don't need an ALS, and we take them to the hospital. That's most of our call volume. Then there's ALS-1, and those are the people where we probably put them on a cardiac monitor and maybe pop an IV in, and they don't get a lot of drugs. ALS-2 is what we rarely bill for, is when we give multiple drugs. I think it's 3 drugs. So that would probably be like a code or a bad trauma or something like that, or a cardiac event. Then that's an ALS-2 billing. And then we also charge through our billing company for loaded miles. So once we get you in the back of the ambulance and we take you to E-Town, so it's generally not very far, we charge for loaded miles. Now, that's the billing side. Now, what the insurance pays is way different than that. Medicaid, as you know, we don't get a lot of reimbursement for. Okay? Medicare, your Social Security, it's not too bad. Okay? And then most people usually have a Medigap policy to pick up the 20% that's not covered by the 80% that's covered by Medicare. And then the Blues are awesome. And no fault is really good. So it really depends. We don't get back everything that we're looking for. Mm-hmm. So, and how we pick our rates is, we haven't changed our rates since October 1st of 2012, because we're trying to be, you know, reasonable with our folks. We just got ranges just the other day for adjusting those rates again. And probably at our next squad meeting, we'll go ahead and adjust the rates for the billing. What I think some agencies don't realize is it's an untapped resource, because some agencies that have the right to bill and don't bill, you know, I've got coverage that covers me being in the back of the ambulance, you know, for as a patient. So why not? It's not any more cost to me. Why not have that, you know, tapped into?
Ability to bill.
Right.
Yeah, and it does kind of... Like, there are towns that we mutual aid for and provide ALS. So we go and provide ALS. If they're an independent agency like us, not associated to the fire department, and we're going to intercept and do a round of drugs or whatever, we can't bill for those services that we're providing to that patient, because they can bill. Unless they're a billing agency, we cannot bill for that.
Right, and there's only one agency, and we don't do a lot of lookups for those guys. The Willsboro calls, the Westport calls, the Essex calls, the Keene Valley calls. We have mutual aid agreements with those guys, and we can bill. So it's not like we're just running over there and not getting covered for the cost of going over there. Okay.
I would thank you both very much.
Oh, thank you. We appreciate it.
And then can I ask just one more? Knowing the intimacy you have there is, where do you see the development of what's happening in the South as far as North, because all the supervisors have talked to me about that in North Hudson, and I just don't understand how the Elizabethtown Lewis could coordinate that in any fashion capability, even though I know that they say this could be the...
Okay, so really quick, because this will take a long time otherwise.
Just a
real quick. Yep. Every agency has a certificate of need, CON.
Okay.
Our CON covers the towns of Elizabethtown and Lewis, including the hamlet of New Russia.
Okay.
That's what ours reads, okay? Ours does not cover North Hudson.
Right.
North Hudson would like us to go down and... Would like us to go down and have an agreement with us for covering their towns. Now, the squad doesn't know that now. The problem with that is, so there's two problems, actually. One is we don't have a CON for that area.
Okay.
And two, three, I haven't discussed it with them yet. And three is, why would I want to stress my folks who are already doing what they can? Right, and then going out to another town to pick up their folks, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We need to take care of our own first.
Leaving us vulnerable while you may be in the South.
Well, not only that, but, you know, what happened, yeah, exactly. I mean, if I take the only person out of town to run the North Hudson and leaves us uncovered, then why would I want to do that?
Okay.
And these guys are already given so much already that,
absolutely,
you know,
yeah.
I don't want to be saying, okay, screw this, I'm getting off the squad.
Yeah, no, that's right. And I'm glad you had that sensitivity. I didn't mean to put you on the spot asking that question.
No, they've talked to me already.
But I think it was necessary for people to understand
that
this is an important consideration for the coverage that we have here in the town of Elizabethtown and Lewis, because things are happening as we speak in other towns.
I'm also the EMS coordinator for the county, and I'll tell you right now, EMS, as well as the fire, is going to implode. There are key people in every town that are holding those agencies together, and if they get sick or wreck a motorcycle, or, you know, which happened, or somebody gets sick, those agencies, those agencies are not going to move an ambulance. And at some point, there will be more paid coverage.
And it actually did. I was working dispatch, and it actually did happen only a week ago, where two key people in another town that run. I mean, they run just about every call every day, and they're doing maybe 4 or 5 calls a day. And one of those key people got hurt on a call, fell, had to be transported to a hospital for a CAT scan. And when they had the next call, they had to call mutual aid because they only had one person, and that was it.
So we're being preemptive and trying to catch it before we have issues. And we're already having issues on weekends, so we're always looking for members. And there's an EMT class starting.
So,
a couple weeks.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I appreciate the opportunity.
And not to, because we mentioned everybody else that was here, because everybody else is in a brown coat tonight. But Deb is also one of our very active squad members. We have 4 Brookses on the squad. It's pretty awesome, actually. And they do pick up quite a bit of time. So, you know, everybody's definitely doing their part.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yep. No, appreciate that. Thank you, Adina.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate your consideration.
Thank you again.
Thanks.
What is that?
Okay. Thank you. I guess we can get back to our agenda, but certainly it's a sobering revelation when you look at really what's happening in the future. And as she was alluding to, as people get older, Anita's in that boat, but Larry and Patty are going to be impossible to replace at that time. We really need to start making preparations going forward. Okay, we may move at this point in time to new business. New business. First under new business is Noble Terrace. Put that there. Mr. Osborne had requested a meeting a week or two ago and asked for permission with some oversight and control communication to utilize Noble Terrace soccer field for practices for the girls' soccer team. This year, as I know most of you are aware, There is one girls soccer team, the modified team, couldn't garner enough numbers, so there is the varsity team. Knowing that we're all taxpayers and we all have a sensitivity to the cost of support and all that, his concern, rightly so, was mobilizing a bus driver every day for practice at the fields in Lewis, and asked, because it was just one team, less number of girls, if it would be okay to, as they had done in the past, practice on Noble Terrace. And I said that I could and did give that authorization, some communication to the board. I did certainly mention to Scott, his other request was, would there be the possibility, even on a trial basis, to also entertain the consideration of hosting home games. There are four home games this year for the varsity girls soccer at the Noble Terrace Field. As you all, you know, can remember here in the last couple of years, we've gone through and had different committees about the usage and the traffic control and the sensitivity of the neighborhood up there in these endeavors. When it was addressed in the past, we were generally talking about more than one team. We were talking about both girls and boys varsity team, a lot higher traffic turnout than what was there. But the request, you know, I'm going to bring forward here for discussion tonight is to allow, with control, oversight, their responsibility, with us partnering in this, to allow a trial for home game at the Noble Terrace Field. The first game would be one of the more populated games because it would be with the Shazy girls varsity team. And I believe that sometime this month, might even be this week, I'm not sure. It's pretty soon. So for discussion, I wanted to bring that up there. I have no issue with them using that as practice. It just makes sense. They don't have to mobilize buses. They don't have to pay bus drivers. It's a safety issue, but it's a tax sensitivity thing also. Now, the school has certainly agreed to shoulder the responsibility of maintenance of the field, all the lining, supplying the warm-up house with, because we have a bathroom there, you know, with whatever supplies would be needed at that time. They would also supply a minimum of two individuals for traffic control and parking. Hopefully there would be more than that. One would be out at the intersection of Noble Terrace and the park entrance. Then there would be another individual just beyond the skating rink to move people into that back field and try to align people in an efficient manner that way. I've talked to Ben, talked to BJ a little bit. First blush for discussion is not to allow parking behind the nets on the roadway leading to the hockey rink, or the skating rink. One of the issues that we had years ago for that is a safety issue with cars coming and going, young children especially who want to be involved. When that ball is kicked over the net, it's a beeline to go get that ball, and they're running between parked cars and there's cars coming in, and it just terrifies me. So that was one of the agreements that Scott would concede, besides supplying the manpower for that, but there would be no parking on that one roadway. So with that being said, I would love to open this up for discussion and just that process to allow the consideration of, on a trial basis, a home game consideration at Noble Terrace.
Which would be Friday, by the way.
It is Friday. Okay, so I can communicate our decisions tonight, tomorrow morning, one way or the other, so that they can prepare for this. And then get your thoughts on just, you know, neighborhood sensitivity. Is this a good thing, a bad thing, and what are your feelings? Doesn't matter who goes first. You have for or against that? You didn't even put a motion if that makes it more legal.
I would support it, and I think at least on a trial basis, see if we have any issues or any complaints back. But
right.
I support it for the good of the taxpayer. Obviously, I think it benefits us all. To a point, may not be a long-term solution, but I don't see a problem with it for now, at least, as a trial thing. The other thing is that if that grass was really high over there, like we talked about, it may be a good idea before they drive over there. I'm not sure how high it is in the back, but it shouldn't be too high to have cars driving into a little bit of unknown area, if that's possible.
Yeah, well, we were gonna think about the brush.
Well, maybe it could be mowed short enough, Jimmy, already. I'm not really sure, but you wouldn't want to take it across off a field with a foot high grass if they don't know what's there.
Right.
That's all.
Yeah. So no, that's a good point. I would ask our highway to see if they, with a brand new brush mower that they have.
They should be doing it a few times a year anyways. Maybe they have.
Right. But that's a good point, because then it's easier to park the people back and forth. You've got that.
I think it's a good, you know, we're saving taxpayer money in a couple places. As long as the school's willing to do the maintenance and
right.
have people there. I think I agree with you that that parking along the back of the nets is crazy. But
yeah, I know we used to be, you know, and I was sensitive enough to say in the past it was a nice thing for the elderly people, because it was a lot of grandmothers and grandfathers who would come and park there because, you know, they had mobility problems and things like that. But to differentiate who can park and who can't park, I think it's easier to just move them in the field. But no, I appreciate your input on that.
I have no problem with it.
BJ?
I'm also.
Okay. Any other comments or questions on that? And then I would, let's see, make a motion that we would allow me to meet with Scott Osborne to go over all the details to prepare for preparation for hosting a home game with the Jay-Z girls this Friday. Is that what you said? This Friday.
And allow them to practice.
And allow them, yeah, to continue practice on that. Thank you. So I would offer that as a motion for a second.
Second
by Mr. Morris. Further discussion on that? Well, with those regulations as discussed?
Should we also allow them to use the building?
Yes. No, that would be part of it. Yeah, because of the bathroom.
It would be their responsibility
yeah.
to make sure that it's
clean,
opened, it's closed, and cleaned, and
yes. Didn't you
not
say
trashed.
They're going to furnish the supplies?
Yes.
Is there any issues in there that we should...
I'll run up sometime prior to that, but I don't think there is. You know, we just try to put
just
everything
move
over
a little bit of stuff somewhere.
And make sure that their people come up and look at it, make sure the bathrooms are supplied.
Because they will want to use the bathrooms.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. The bathroom.
No, that's what allows that field to be. I've even, whether they would do it or not, that, you know, we have that small kitchenette there. Mm-hmm. If one of the classes for whatever fundraising, if they wanted to pop hot dogs.
And they usually do have sell some stuff at the
Yeah, so I told them, I said that could be all part of their, you know, responsibility of the building
right.
also. It's just something, it's good for the people who come to watch the games. Bless you.
Yeah.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? I will meet with Mr. Osborne tomorrow and on that. Thank you. Next, sewer. We, I think, are close to a conclusion of the litigation. With the sewer project. The reason why I put that down there is the one thing that we're waiting on right now is I have contacted the DEC to get written confirmation that they will reopen that contract with the information that we have been apprised of at the meeting with the attorneys. On that, and until that moves forward, unfortunately, the gentleman who was the manager and had some familiarity with the history of the project, he retired officially about 2 weeks ago. So he is not available, and then the new person who has all that information has not contacted me back. But I've been promised that we will have this all resolved before the end of this month. As far as the DEC's representation, and then we can bring it back to the attorneys and all that. So I just wanted to give you that update on that, because the one loose end there was the DEC. So hopefully next month we will have a much more complete report on that process moving forward. Questions, comments on that? All right, then, moving right to Section 7 Cross Country. As everybody remembers, over the years, we have given the authority for Section 7 to use the Cobble Hill Golf Course for the Section 7 state qualifying cross country meet. And this year, the date is scheduled for Friday, October 31st. You can bring your costumes. Mr. Brian Keeley, I think we've done this as long as I can remember. You know, it's gone back about a year. So I'm just asking for a motion to again allow this. It's a great opportunity. The school opens up for them to use, but it's just it's a great exposure for the town of Elizabethtown to get all those people here in Dodge. It's a good thing.
I'll make the motion.
Moved by Mr. Wright.
I'll second.
Second by Mr. Phillips. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much. Next, then on budget. 2015, I have that written down so that we can, once you've all looked at your schedules and want to pick out some dates for budget workshops, probably starting in October, if that works for you. Are there better days, good days, bad days, more better than others, or do you just want me to pick days?
Pick a day.
So you don't, well, yeah, Fridays are out, Mondays are out, so Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, any of those days?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm good.
Preferable times, doesn't matter. Because I don't mind doing one during the day, but everybody works, so early evening.
And after 4 o'clock for me.
Okay. On that line of thought, is sometimes earlier better, 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock?
It's,
doesn't matter to me one way or the other.
I'm here. Good. Day to day for me, normal size.
Right,
but if it's,
okay.
You know, I can't really.
All right, then I'll memo you guys first, then, and, you know, just give you a variety of dates, and then you can just get back to me, and then, you know, I can put whatever ads we got to do.
Just pick one, and we either we're coming or we're not.
Okay. but it's helpful if you're here. That's well, why I'm doing this.
You might get 3 of us, you might get 2 of us.
Alrighty, then I shall pick some dates.
Would you think about like 3 or 4 by the time you're done or something like that? Or?
At least 2.
Okay.
When we start. You know, the first one would be the preliminary. You know, and I'll have that all put together here within probably the end of next week.
Okay.
You know, I'll have all those figures. And that's sort of a starting point.
I could probably give you dates that won't work.
Right, and I'll try to, you know, around the soccer schedule, because y'all have soccer and stuff like that,
yeah.
So, you know.
So that's usually meet until 6:30 at least.
We're going to be working until 3 or 4, so.
Okay.
October 18th through October, for a week.
Okay, so prior to October 18th. I'll remember that one.
No.
That's right. Okay, that's all I had for the budget. We at that time then also, you know, I'll have more information on tax cap information, things like that, some of the considerations that we had just been made aware of tonight are really going to complicate the considerations of you know, going forward and meeting that tax cap or preparing to override the tax cap, make some representation to the constituency. But those are significant increases that have been represented tonight. It'd be hard to absorb something like that unless we cut everything else. But sometimes it's a necessity to do the unpopular thing. Okay, any other new business that you don't see that you would like to talk about? We would go to committees. Highway Department. What's new?
I haven't seen nobody.
I haven't seen anybody. No. I think on Meggsville, we must be close. I know the culvert's in, they've done the prep. I think that they're planning on doing some pavement here pretty soon, but I'm not positive on that. But again, I will write Noble Terrace to make sure that is brushed out, if they can do that. Any other issues with the Highway Department at this point? None.
Water District. I think we went over some of the things that are pending right now for the Water District. Hopefully Dave would have a little more time once that's done with at least two of the men to be able to remediate the rest of that water project and the breaks that we have presently at the other spot. Valve replacement. Resnick, I think, like I said, within 2 weeks, should be able to schedule that in. Dave has to be there for coordination, and Jack will be online to walk us through that. Planning Board, Mr. Bruce Pouchet. Anything you'd like to...
Yeah, more quickly.
Sure.
The Planning Board received two letters of interest regarding the alternate position on the Planning Board that's been vacant for months.
Yeah.
I believe proper procedure was followed by placing an advertisement in the Valley News, freshman, a couple months ago, Deb.
Maybe. I did check the date for sure, but
it's
June, I think.
Had ample time to send a letter if they wish to Planning Board or email me. We did receive two letters. One has been withdrawn, and the other one is for Evelyn Hatch. And the Planning Board is delighted to announce that the Planning Board unanimously supports Evelyn Hatch. Her letters speak for itself, which I trust you all received a copy. And the Planning Board respectfully asks the Town Board to install Evelyn to the Planning Board tonight as an alternate member. That's it.
Okay. Bruce was in the other day, and we had a very brief discussion, you know, on that. And I had been contacted by two individuals, and I'd asked Bruce if they wanted to see the letters of interest from those individuals, and then go back and make a determination once to see the other names. Apparently, you prefer not to do that.
Well, don't look at it.
Because as we talked the other day, I said that I did have that I was ready to present forward. But on that same line of thought, you would prefer then to go forward. And I did pass the letters out for Ms. Hatch. So I'm ready to attend to that, if that's what you would prefer to do.
Well, I think it's been a long time.
Yes.
And... I mean, shouldn't they have sent the letter to the Planning Board that we make a recommendation to the Town Board? But
right.
If you have two other applicants, we could look for sure.
Well, it's up to you. That's why I'm asking. You know,
board.
I would just right. Is I just wanted to, because you did present it forward for us to address tonight. I can do that. Or as you know, I thought we talked about yesterday that I would give you the opportunity to at least see those other names.
Well, you have one letter
matter.
Or two.
I've got one letter, and the other individual, you know, I had talked to that individual and said, you know, if you want to proceed with this, I do need something in writing, as I told you.
Well, we meet next week, right?
Is it next week? Okay.
Next Tuesday. I mean, to be fair, we can wait, but we're going to have to wait another month.
Right. No, that's true, too.
It would be nice to have someone on board and help us, but...
Right.
It's up to you guys. You have the power.
True. So that was it, is if you wanted me to move forward, I was just simply going to ask for a table of the consideration. But if you would wait and allow me to at least submit the one that I have to you, then... You know, it is another month, but it is an alternate position.
Right.
I just thought it would be fair if for some reason why they didn't contact you. I'm not sure, but it's not my business.
I mean, we're happy to look at it.
Okay. Thank you. No, I appreciate that. Okay. And I will get back to that other individual. Maybe he will not supply something in writing. I'm not sure. But I will ask before the end of the week's out. Thank you. Okay. Couple Hole Golf Course. We are coursing down on that, we did hire another individual to fill the gaps. We had lost Mr. Mallory. He went back to college. The suites are making some other provisions right now. And we needed extra coverage for Joyce Rosenbaum. Trish is still filling in for another 2 weeks. So there was a resolution on the books, I believe it was last year, for Joe Ratliff. No, I think you were here at that time. And there was a board resolution at that time offering the supervisor authority to hire Joe Ratliff. So instead of me going back out and waiting because we had to have somebody quick, I used it on that basis of resolution that the board had, this is a prior board, made those provisions at that time for that. I mean, they ended up hiring somebody else, but the board resolution that was stated was for Joe Ratliff. So I just felt that was, to work as an attendant for right there. And right now he's sort of being trained in not only the credit card and taking things like that, but also when Joyce has other things to do and she can cover it, then he's out working right now, temporarily. But it's just that time of the year where we just don't have backup for Joyce, so we just had to do something. And it's at, the low rate that Hunter's
getting.
Yeah, was at. So at that same rate, just another one. And we had, he was part of that job application group anyways. So that's the development there. I have not made any progress on the new hole. They're starting to cut it more. It's been top dressed. But other than that, I'm just a little bit frustrated that we're not any closer in that capacity. To say we're ready to open that new bowl. Yeah.
Do we have a list or something that we know that we absolutely need to finish? I mean, I know it's pretty obvious if you go up there and look, we know, but I mean, is there actually a punch list at this point? Would that be a good way to start?
But that would be a nice thing to have,
sitting here after a month or two, it's kind of hard for us to say, well, we need one more stage without.
It is, and it's hard to see the progress for the green that's there because,
that's getting better.
Yeah, that has been cut, has been top dressed a couple times, but it's still got some issues there. The wall that's coming down, I still think we have some erosion problems. And for just, I know we had the opportunity just to bring in topsoil. That doesn't solve a problem.
I mentioned a couple of things to Bruce, and he told me don't worry about it. So.
Yeah. At one of our budget workshops, I may even ask for actually a end of the season Cobble Hill golf course workshop. I think we might be at that point in time. Mm-hmm. Though we might have a quick special meeting. We have to address some of the issues here, if you will. Go over that. We need to make some decisions here. It has to be.
This has got to be ready by next year. I mean, it's
one question. We cannot open that ninth hole.
No,
we can't. Okay, so allow me to, in the scheduling then, to try to find out a little more where we are. But the last time I was over there and I mentioned topsoil, the representation was starting to address the old part of the sixth green and ready to take that up 3 feet and put it in the green. And I'm getting frustrated here. We're not going to start a new project until that project has been done.
Finished one that we got money and
so
time.
I just needed to bring it all up to speed on that. So I think that does require a special meeting specific for that. And you guys, have been in the business a long time. It's not
just didn't want
that
to
complicated.
Listen. You didn't want to listen to the idea I had there. We'll try to fix that.
Right. Okay. So I will try to set up one of those times with the workshops, and that might even be part of one of the budget workshops because Cobble Hill is certainly part of that budget.
Yeah.
Okay, on the Youth Commission, I just gave you, just so you know, the finality of it, the settlement agreement with the Department of Health, Mr. Callahan. So that you know, stems, and we negotiated the fine. It was ridiculous. Well, I wouldn't say ridiculous. It was a fine. We ended up, Mr. Blades did negotiate that down to half, so $25, but at least it's all been removed and done. That's been taken care of. Okay, last but not least, Blueberry Trails. Oh, I was contacted just today by Chris Marin from the Cats Trails. Chris has been very active for a long time in Cats, you know, and all that. As part of one of their grants that they've got, he has signage, numerous signs or something like that, that represents a hiker, I guess. It's a figurine type of thing with an arrow to do that. And so he's asked for consideration, would you be interested in having strategically placed? He was mentioning one maybe down by the footbridge, even though there's already a sign there. He said this gets people visual attention quicker. You know, there's a sign there saying park, but then if there's a hiker, something else. Also leading up to the Blueberry Trails and maybe up above. But he has three or four. And before I would just say go put them up, I'll bring back the information of the placement that he's suggesting for that.
Okay.
But, you know, no cost to the town, but maybe get part of that whole cat.
Huh? Can you get one so we can look at it? Or it's just a hiker, you say?
Yeah, he was just describing it to me. Yeah, it looks like a signpost with a figurine that must represent a hiker or something like that. Also, so I'll get that information for you and bring it back. In the near future, the consideration that would ask the board here, we've done it in the past for two different individuals on the top of Bronson Way. As you know, there's town property, then there's other private property, property ownerships up there. Three or four years ago, we, as a board, allowed a temporary right-of-way or easement for logging onto Bronson Way to use that road to bring logs out from those private properties up above. I was contacted generically by another property owner who just asked that I bring this forward. It's nothing we need to make a decision on this month, or probably not in a couple months, but just to lay the groundwork for consideration that the easements that right-of-ways that we had negotiated before, we have the contracts, we have the road maintenance, we have all of the provisions in there, so that there isn't the gray area of possible damage that we would have to incur and all that. It's just trying to be good neighbors if the road is there and they can create a header close enough. So as I get more information, I will bring that back, if in fact they're really going to go through with this, but I'll ask them that. So I just wanted to give you a heads up that maybe coming down the road. Any other committees that I don't have listed that you want to talk about?
On the blueberries thing that we were still talking about for a long time now, trying to make it the parking lot.
Oh, you're right.
A little better. And when I was at one of the Blueberry Hill meetings, it was a few months ago now, but
right.
Jess said she was going to try to talk to him again, and then, you know, I was wondering if we really needed to. Can we just make that the way it should have been done in the first place, or ask the highway to try to help? And
I think that we could.
I mean, it's just...
I thought that, again, she was going to contact Mountain Lake Services,
to
make sure.
See, you know, if they would allow us to do something different or do something we were going to do the first time.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure.
Yeah, to increase the size
just
a little bit.
Increase the size, and maybe so there's not a bank there, and it's a little better way of parking. And I think, I mean, you don't want to make a big parking lot, but it was really, I don't think it was ever quite made the way it should have been
pulling in like that, and then you have room for five cars there instead of two.
You know, as long as we're on the Blueberry Hill subject, I think.
No, I'm glad you brought
it up. But I'm just not sure if we're allowed to go work on it or not. That's the point.
Right. I think that Mountain Lake Services should be talked to first before we go make money digging.
No, that's true, and I think as we left it before, that Jess was gonna call them or contact them.
I don't think there'd be any problem, but.
No.
We wouldn't have to use any more of their property, if there was any of their property to begin with, I think, I guess.
You'd probably want another 5 feet in or something like that.
Possibly, but at least take out the bank, so it's.
Right. But I'll contact Jess, and then if she hasn't, I'll contact Mountain Lake Services and try to reinitiate.
It's also not the best looking parking lot up there, I'm worried about now.
That's true. You're right.
That bank should be sloped down.
And it's used.
Get it back to where you want it, and slope it down like that, and then, you know, and some, that way there, the, it'd be easier to take care of, and it'll look better.
It would just look better.
And there's people there every day.
Every day.
Every day.
You're right, man.
And one car can actually almost clog the whole thing.
Yep, parked in the middle. I see it go by there every day.
It's a good lot, for one, but if they park exactly right, it's pretty much taking up the whole thing.
No, that's true.
Another thing too, with the snow there, I put up, there was somebody stuck there, I put it around so they could get that. If it was slow, at least you'd come in with a plow, you'd push the snow up the bank, you know.
You should be able to make a nice little lot there better than we have.
Yeah. Okay, I'll make some of those contacts this week. Alrighty, any other comments for committees that aren't there, or any other comments?
None for me.
Okay. Then we shall move to comments. Public comments, public comment period. Are there members of the public who would like to address the board tonight? Margaret Markley.
A couple things. I was really impressed by the maps that Anita brought in, and I wondered if they could be put out in the lobby so that if anybody in the public wanted to look at it, they would be available. I'm sure some of you want to look at them, but I think they look like they're really doing a good job there. The other is just a suggestion, and I happened to see it recently when I was in Saratoga. They were flushing their hydrants, which we have to do twice a year. And I know getting that information out is difficult, particularly if you try to put it in the paper and then there's a delay, then you have to put it in the paper again. I noticed in Saratoga they had signs, very much like political signs, the kind that you stick in the ground. They were red, and they said, Saratoga Water Department flushing this week, and they just stuck them out along the road the week they were going to do it. And they were very visible. They were like really like almost fluorescent red with black letters. And I thought, boy, nobody misses that. And there was no date, it just said this week. And I thought, you know, you could order up a dozen of those, and I think it would make it a lot easier. I mean, you still might have to put a notice in the paper, but I'm telling you, you couldn't miss those. I thought it was a really good idea.
I'll mention that today for sure. Yeah, and as far as the maps go, you know, probably they'd be in this room also. You know, just start taping them up because they are very nice maps. They seem to be. Any other members of the audience? Sure.
Ms.
Bruce Pouchet.
Lloyd Road, is that a town road?
Yes.
And so the town owns 25 feet from the middle, is that how it works?
Generically, yeah, from the center line. That's generally the way they.
I mean, is
interpret
that parking lot that far in?
Yeah. No, probably. I think that was more of a consideration of neighbors more than anything. I think that's it, because, you know, it was their plot and stuff like that. But you're right. It's probably within our right-of-way, at least what's been put in there now.
Yeah. Okay.
So we could probably do that.
We're going in front of the planning board and zoning board.
it's out of the hand.
I would like to add, when we were putting that in originally, I believe Mountain Lake Services has a well field up there, and there was some concern from them on how close you were getting into their well field.
Right.
Because there is a well cap up there.
Yeah.
And that's what they brought up at the time, is the proximity of the well field.
There's there, but Mr. Mills, his well is right back there.
Yeah, I knew there was a well field up there.
Yeah, that is part of it. Mr. Bernard Dusso.
Water Street. Yes. Is there any way we can get a sign at both ends of that? Or even if they put up a bridge sign, you know what I mean?
No, it's true.
Make a detour, because somebody's gonna get killed up there. Like I said today, there was two cars that went down there from Vermont, and they were doing 60 miles an hour. But they came down over, pardon my French, and that's the name of it. That's what it says on my map, Nigger Hill. So,
oh.
And that's just what it says on my deed. So that's the way I gotta.
Right through there. Yeah.
But I take them down, you know what I mean? And that when they get to that bridge, they got that Jersey barrier, and boom, they go right over on the other side, and somebody's going to get. I bought a mirror, and I'm going to see if I can get Towns to put it up. I bought the mirror and see if they'll put it up.
To see it. Right on that back corner.
There. Right on the across the driveway, so we can see.
And to make people aware, Bernard, or Mr. Dusso and I had talked. His first suggestion was you need to put up a sign that says, local traffic only. You can do that. Certainly, I'd love to be able to take that opportunity. As I was trying to explain, and he understands, you know, the legalities of me going through the DPW of the county, but bigger than that, the DOT, the state, it is a state bridge. I would love, and I would do it in a heartbeat, you know, if we could somehow pass that through the agencies, or if, as you pointed out, if the bridge with the Jersey barriers now right in the middle creates more of a traffic hazard, I would love to be able to determine that bridge is unsafe, you know, and just be able to stop local traffic only. That might be enough to at least break the problems that we're experiencing here on a regular basis.
I'll tell you what happens is about six or seven cars come down through there all at the same time. Two or three behind don't want to follow anymore, so they take the shortcut to try to beat the ones that are going down to go through the village.
Yeah.
And I've had them pass me on Water Street, and that double solid line all the way, and you try to get your license plate number and forget it.
And I will put out request to the county sheriff, because, you know, as we know, it's not a matter of speed limit signs, it's a matter of enforcement. You know, if we can have speed traps down there, well, that will slow the local traffic down. It doesn't do a hell of a lot for Vermont and New Hampshire people who are just going to Lake Placid. But absolutely, it's an ongoing issue.
Your GPS system, that gives them a direct route.
Yeah.
That's 90% of it.
No. And we haven't been able to override that. We've had IT people at the county try to get into that, and it's like dealing with the clouds. It really is. But I do appreciate your, you know, concern with it, and it is a safety issue.
Put up the same bridge out of local traffic on them.
I'd love to. Put that up for Halloween, see how long it lasts.
They do traffic tickets by the camera.
I know, you know, that's true.
That's for sure. Yeah. If you run a red light in a lot of the towns around here or cities, you'll get a bill in the mail.
There more, but it can't be. Yeah. Like a week or so ago, I saw 2-3 troopers up through there.
I know.
They go through there a lot.
They do. And I hate to get to the point of putting out temporary speed bumps.
No.
Because, you know, it just the locals pay for it, but sometimes that's the only issue. And I know there's some liability. You can't do it with plowing or snow. You only hit it once. You'll stop the next time.
You got these two speed bumps, you plow right over them.
Really? No. So, but anyways, no, I'm not deferring that at all. It is an issue, and it's something we're working on as much as we can. Other comments for the board, Mr. Ken Fenimore?
Just a couple other things about the Blueberry Trail system. The cyan box on the lower road entrance is falling apart. And perhaps they're already aware of that, but the weather is.
So that wasn't fixed.
Get at the sign in book and all that. Okay. The bottom's just falling out of it. And there have been no maps in that bulletin board box for probably a year and a half. I do not have a copy of the most current mapping that's available. I think that Jess Bueller did some kind of color mapping of all of the new trails. I'd make some copies myself, and I could, I suppose, with some of the older versions of maps, but there haven't been any in that sign-in box for, like I say, for at least a year and a half. Okay. The if you're having committee member meetings, that would be an appropriate time to bring those things up. With respect to the logging, from the sand pit up to the town's property line or gate, that road's really, really rough up through there. It's like a creek bed. I'd be surprised if log trucks can get through there, actually. So you might be facing the issue of who's going to fix the road, what will happen, what will need to be done to that road in order to make it passable for heavy trucks.
I think the one they're talking about is just up to the gate, or not up to the gate, just beyond Santa. There's the two gates right there before you go up above. Yeah, I think that, because that was the one that we gave the access to 3 years ago. It wasn't way up on top, it was right down.
Well, the section of road from the sand pit up to the town property line at that closed gate,
okay.
So it's closed. That's the real rough section.
Okay.
And it's very rough. Right. I don't know where you're talking about with logging, where they're coming from, but I assume it's beyond that gate.
Right. Yeah. So that would be the point coming to it. It would be their responsibility. You know, we're not going to fix the road.
I wouldn't go through there in a four-wheel drive pickup truck even.
Okay.
It's that rough.
Washed out, kind of thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just erosion,
yeah.
But it's significant erosion.
No, I thank you.
What about that box? Who gets my fix in?
What?
That box.
Registration box.
Yep, we got that written down. Box, and then put maps in a box. So we got it. No.
Well, you know, so something like that, to fix something like that, you know, the Blueberry Hills Committee isn't going to fix anything.
No.
I mean, not that they wouldn't, but I just mean, you know, that's where we can use, you know, maybe people at the golf course.
That's
generally
what we do.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so I get in touch over there, and then they pick it up, bring it over there, fix it, and bring it back, just like the signs. That'll be on their list here this week to do that.
Yeah.
You know, it's... But like you say, there's people there, and it's that time of the year. There'll be more people up there than there will be here in town. You know, 4 o'clock on a Saturday. It's amazing how many people go up there, and now that the leaf season's upon us, it's a busy spot. We have a lot of people come in here for maps, you know, just during the day. We really do.
Fiesta, what if he has to go up there for the brush dump with the dozer at all, or if it's up there? Is it now?
I don't think it is. No, it was. We transferred it back about 2 weeks ago. The brush dump is getting full, and that's another address that we've got to do. DEC was supposed to be here the end of August to do, and I haven't received any word on that, of the audit once we did push everything back, but it's all right back out to the road right now. So we've had the loader go up once or twice, but the dozer hasn't been up there for 2 weeks. We may have to arrange to push that back.
Check the road at the same time up there. I don't know if
that's... No, that's a good point.
No.
Just
a comment. The road where it was washed out above the sand pit.
Yes.
I mean, there was a PW written by FEMA to repair that. So the town received $2,000 or $3,000. I can't remember how much it was.
Yes.
But it was in the PW on that to fix it.
Right.
That was something that Bruce was going to go up and do.
I know. It's on that specifically because we went up. That was even before Irene.
This was last summer.
Oh, last summer.
Last 4129 disaster.
Oh, okay. Because we received some the first one way before.
No,
Irene,
this was last summer. There's okay. Money that just came in on would have just come in on that
for that. Okay. Because I knew the other one. We had the upper portion that FEMA had identified. But I know that's part of what we were talking about, the washout. We renegotiated, and then just at the time of Irene, we were able to use the gravel that they had designated for us to use that, and we used that on the lower part of the road so that we were able to bring stuff up to the where we got all the cobble at that time. So we had to fix that section of the road. FEMA allowed us to use the material for that on the lower part of the road. But no, I appreciate that. We'll see where that goes. Okay, any other comments? For the board, public comments.
I have one.
Yes,
the Blueberry Trail maps are online, so if you need to get a quick reference to that.
No firm.
Also, what is that noise, that rattling in the back? Is that
That's reminding us that our check valves or circulation valves.
Heating system needs to be checked.
I thought maybe had somebody chained up back there.
Tomorrow.
No, so we sort of shut it down for the summer, and then 2 days ago it was so cold in here, so I went to turn it on. And that's
That's what you get.
That's when you know. You know, one of the circulators just trying to remind us it's time to get oil or something. Comments for the board? No? Good?
I had three people tell me to tell you thank you for getting that cemetery mold.
Oh, thank you. And I know it's that time of year again. We've got to do all the cemeteries.
That's not bad, then.
One more time. It isn't too bad?
No, that's not bad. It's good. Pretty good. I think it is, but.
Okay. No, thank you. No. Dan did a good job on that.
The woman there that with her daughter in there, she called me and told me to tell you thank you.
Okay. No, thank you. I appreciate that. Mr. Wright. You're good. With that, we will move to financials. I would ask first for a motion to okay the transfers. Transfers, which is on your last page. There's only a few of them. Right here. Motion to transfer. Who feels right? I'll offer that motion to allow representative transfers. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Second by Mr. Phillips. On the table, questions or comments now on the transfers. As you can see, and some of those transfers are because there was no budget there for some of that stuff. So mixing and matching, we still have quite a bit of contingency. That's why I don't use contingency very much. The tax and assessment, you know, $800, that was just a miss at budget time last year. You know, that's not a surprise. That's a regular reoccurring cost. Code enforcement, same way, just transferring contractuals from lumbering to cover those costs. With the rest is self-explanatory. So I took some of your contractuals, that $60.22 from the town board. You know, that's what you do when you do these transfers. Questions or comments on the transfers? Being none, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Morris?
Yes.
Mr. Alcott?
Yes.
Mr. Phillips?
Yes.
Mr. Wright?
Yes.
And Mr. Mayor?
Yes, thank you. Then also a motion to approve the supervisor's report.
I'll make the motion.
Moved by Mr. Wright.
Second.
Second by Mr. Alcott. On the supervisor's report, questions, comments, and you'll see the things reflect some of the transfers. Being none, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Morris?
Yes.
Mr. Alcott?
Yes.
Mr. Phillips?
Yes.
Mr. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Arriola?
Yes. Thank you. And finally, a motion to pay all bills.
I make a motion to pay all bills.
Moved by Mr. Morris. Second. Second by Mr. Alcott. Comments, questions, discussion? Being none, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Morris?
Yes.
Mr. Alcott?
Yes.
Mr. Phillips?
Yes.
Mr. Wright?
Yes.
And Mr. Merrick?
Yes. Thank you. Any further business to come before this board? Motion to adjourn. Second. All those in favor? We stand adjourned. Thank you.